vertical farming has been called the future of agriculture, claimed to solve many of the problems we talked about in the last video. It's been a controversial topic, with mixed opinions from experts. Are these claims hype, or can it deliver? But first, we need a better understanding of what a vertical farm is. There are many different versions, and they all have vastly different capabilities. Part of the problem is the many types of farm and confusing array of definitions. So let's deal with those first. Vertical farming and urban farming are both umbrella terms that are sometimes used interchangeably, although they are not the same. Urban agriculture includes a broad array of concepts. It essentially focuses on bringing food production into the city in order to move the production as close to consumption as possible. This may include the usage of vertical farms, or may involve more traditional growing practices in an urban environment. While vertical farms can be urban, they don't have to be. Therefore, all vertical farming references in this video won't be restricted to urban environments. While vertical farms can use soil, most utilize hydro, aero, or aquaponics. These methods use much less water than typically used in soil. Hydroponics replaces soil by using a circulating water and nutrient mix for plant growth. Aeroponics uses an open membrane and a water mist spray with a nutrient mix. Aquaponics uses hydroponics and an aquatic ecosystem to balance nutrients in both systems. I won't be discussing the aquaponics variant in this video. Strictly speaking, the term vertical farm could be used in reference to structures that grow food on multiple levels. This could range from small-scale hobby spaces to large automated buildings. So let's quickly take a look at which versions of this technology have the most promise to positively impact our global issues. For many, the image of a vertical farm is a city skyscraper filled with fruit, vegetables, trees, and perhaps even animals. While some look amazing, it can be hard to argue that these images lend credibility to the vertical farming concept. Skyscrapers represent very expensive real estate and are usually reserved for high-value activities. Growing fruit on trees or rearing animals humanely have a low value density. This isn't a problem if you have acres of cheap land to produce on, but it is if you're using premium real estate. Even if you're growing a dense premium crop, the cost of growing also increases exponentially with height. The requirements to pump water and move biomass vertically takes considerable energy. This may be insignificant for a 10-level farm, but would likely be prohibitive for a farm with hundreds or thousands of levels. While there are a number of architectural concepts for skyscraper farms, as yet, only one is being built. The World Food Building is currently under construction in Linköping, Sweden. While information for this building is limited, even if it achieves its target cost of $40 million, it's highly unlikely to recoup that money with its production capacity of 550 tons of vegetables per year. Wall farms and rooftop farms often share a similar visual appeal to skyscraper farms. Unlike skyscraper farms, these don't displace existing real estate. Instead, they aim to utilize unused spaces to grow food. As such, the cost of adding these types of farm is often minimal. Many of these farms are created by hobbyists and double as gardens. As such, the addition of green space to the urban environment is considered a welcome one. While this is good news, the amount of usable surfaces for growing food is extremely limited. In fact, Dickinson Despommier, the man who was credited with inventing the term vertical farm, came up with the concept after his students calculated that rooftop farming could supply just 2% of 2050 New York's population by fully utilizing all of its rooftops for growing. This is when he turned to the idea of skyscraper farms. Even if we utilized all usable rooftops in the world, we would only be able to save a fraction of a percent of global land. So while rooftop and wall farms aren't a bad use of otherwise wasted space, their ability to affect the global challenges are negligible. Vertical greenhouses are largely transparent structures that utilize multiple growing levels. One of the challenges that is introduced by stacking greenhouse levels on top of each other is providing enough light, as the glass or polymer structure already absorbs some of the sunlight, and stacking vertically increases the risk of shadows. Vertical greenhouses can get around this problem by rotating the levels to get a relatively even distribution of sunlight and adding supplementary artificial light. Vertical greenhouses can grow at a higher plant density than a typical greenhouse, although capital costs and electricity costs are higher. This makes them better suited to urban environments where land is at a premium. Vertical greenhouses essentially allow you to move production closer to consumption. Both horizontal or vertical hydroponic greenhouses are promising technologies that will help combat the global challenges, as they require 10 to 15 times less land and water than traditional agriculture. Given that commercial hydroponic greenhouses are a relatively mature industry, their viability and scalability is not in question. These greenhouses can grow a broad range of fruits and vegetables, but are not used to grow staple crops such as wheat, which accounts for the majority of land and water demand. They're also partially exposed to the climate and local light levels, which makes them expensive to run in some areas. If we use greenhouses to produce our global vegetables and some fruits, we would save less than 2% of our global land, barely enough to offset the projected 2050 land loss, and less than half of the 55% increase in water demand. While greenhouses may alleviate some of the global challenges, it's not enough to be able to prevent the worst of the problems. If we really want to stop and reverse the global challenges, we will need a more radical approach. Plant factories are the most technologically advanced version of the vertical farm. They are airtight, highly climate-controlled buildings with a CO2-enriched atmosphere. They're essentially clean rooms, like those used in drug or satellite production. Production rooms contain plants on multiple levels. They are sealed and thermally insulated with no windows, relying on 100% artificial lighting. They are aero or hydroponic, where transpired water vapor from the plant is captured and condensed, recycling it back into the hydroponic nutrient mix. They are typically warehouse-sized buildings, no more than a few stories in height. Plant factories offer the greatest level of land and water savings of all vertical farms. They also have the highest level of control and growing conditions, meaning that they can grow any type of plant in any region of the world. They're not exposed to bad weather or failed harvests. This gives them the potential to have the greatest impact on the global challenges. Therefore, for the purposes of this video, when I refer to vertical farms, I'm talking about plant factories, as they are the most viable version of this technology. Although, as we will discover, plant factories introduce their own challenges. While they have a greater level of real-world practicality, they still face criticisms around cost, real estate, and energy consumption. So how valid are these criticisms? In order for vertical farming to positively change the world, it needs to be technologically feasible, environmentally sustainable, or at least better than current practices, and economically viable. While this industry is still in an early phase, from a technological standpoint, vertical farming works. While it is true that the current farms focused almost exclusively on leafy greens and herbs, pretty much any crop can already be produced this way with existing technology. Vertical farms use less water than traditional agriculture, a lot less. In the best vertical farms, 1 kilogram of lettuce requires 1.2 liters of water. This is especially impressive given that lettuce is 95% water. 1.2 liters is 17 times better than a normal hydroponic greenhouse. And in stark contrast, field-grown lettuce requires a staggering 237 liters per kilogram of lettuce. That's 200 times more water. The water saved has the potential for a huge positive impact on water security and reversing wetland destruction. Vertical farms don't need pesticides. They require little fertilizer and don't have uncontrolled agricultural runoff. These factors combined is great news for freshwater wildlife. Since they can be built near population centers, Proponents of this technology often argue that urban farms allow for a reduction in carbon emissions due to a reduction in food transport. While this is largely true, the extent of the benefit is often exaggerated from a climate perspective. Food transport makes up a relatively small portion of agricultural emissions. The real environmental opportunity for vertical farming is the potential to return farmland to forest and shrubland. This will be a massive benefit for wildlife conservation efforts and also has promise for significant global carbon sequestration. But how much land can it save? This technology has a vastly greater yield for a given area, with the cutting-edge farms having a growing density over 100 times greater than field grown. This has enormous potential for reversing deforestation and habitat destruction. There is an elephant in the room, however. Vertical farms trade energy for density and control. It's how they achieve massive yields for a small area of land. Artificial lighting accounts for 80% of the farm's energy costs. Based on the current global energy mix, most of that energy requires carbon emissions to produce. So on balance, are plant factories good for the environment? And can they be solar powered? This is something we will investigate in the next video. Vertical farms can be expensive to set up, especially if you want a big operation. Running costs can be high from a labour and electricity perspective. While labour costs shrink with the scale of the operation, it's difficult to shrink the electricity costs. Plants need light energy to grow. In a field, the sun provides that for free. In a vertical farm, it must be supplied. Since leafy greens and herbs have a low light requirement and reasonable profit margins, they are much more economically viable. There are hundreds of them in operation around the world. Some of them are massive in scale, capable of producing 30,000 heads of lettuce per day from a single farm. A 2014 study of 165 Japanese vertical farms found that 25% were profitable, 50% were breaking even, and 25% were making a loss. These are promising numbers for such a new industry. Rapid technological improvements and a greatly expanding knowledge base have greatly improved the profitability in just the 4 short years since the study. In fact, the question is no longer, can a vertical farm work, but how big can this industry get? And will this industry ever grow more than leafy greens? Despite being in its infancy, this technology already accounted for 1% of Japan's lettuce production in 2014 from 165 vertical farms. While the number of farms has increased significantly since then, so has the size of the farms. This year, a single farm opened which will supply 0.6% of the whole Japanese lettuce market. In 2015, the vertical farming industry was worth $1.15 billion. In 2024, it's projected to be an industry worth over $13 billion. Just last year, the US firm Plenty raised $226 million with their plan to roll out their farms near every major US city. With investment from the world's richest man Jeff Bezos, it's a significant statement for the industry. But it's not just the big companies. For $85,000, you can buy a shipping container with a fully installed farm inside, and it's delivered directly to you. This container requires 1% of an acre, but can produce 20% of an acre's worth of produce. This low cost of entry makes vertical farming very accessible to entrepreneurs, and many are getting involved. A lack of investment certainly isn't this industry's barrier to growth. But what about market size? Many of these operations focus on the premium end of the market because they are capable of delivering the highest quality produce. But they also focus on it out of necessity, since the bigger profit margins afforded by premium products offset the labor and energy costs of the operation. While this is good news for current businesses, plant factories will have to compete on price with traditional growing methods, or its ability to impact at a global level will be severely limited. Only a small percentage of the market is willing to pay a big premium for high quality, environmentally friendly products. The more vertical farming shifts to the right on the graph, the bigger the size of the market becomes. For the leafy green market, the cost of production is shrinking fast. As of 2018, a number of vertical farm products are cost competitive with the market, although many are still sold at a premium to enhance profits. Taking a look at a suburban medium-sized farm from Japan 2015, we can see just how close to market cost they were. They were able to sustainably sell at a price just 12% above the country's wholesale price. Looking into their costs, we get a sense of the opportunity at hand. In fact, the cutting-edge plant factories are likely to have a cost breakdown that looks more like this. Year on year, yields continue to increase for given inputs, and the cost of the inputs continues to fall. The electricity, depreciation, and labor costs are falling every year as technologies continue to improve, something we will look at in more detail in the next video. This means for leafy greens at least, vertical farms are in a position to corner the market. If vertical farms take over the leafy green market, what impact will this have on our global challenges? Lettuce growing uses over 9 trillion litres of fresh water every year, but that accounts for just 0.02% of global fresh water. And lettuce accounts for just 0.1% of our agricultural land usage. While the leafy green market is more than just lettuce, the reality is it's just a small fraction of global agriculture. To make a big global impact, vertical farming needs to be able to economically grow a broader range of produce. But what will it take to be able to grow more types of food? Almost all crops can be grown hydroponically. So in principle, vertical farms could grow almost all of our global crops. So why aren't we doing that? And if we could, how big could the impact be? Let's find out.